Welcome to another edition of Grace Under Pressure, where my guest today is Michael Stallard. Those of you who know the show know that we pose questions to thought leaders and doers like Michael, who are changing the world for the better. And Grace Under Pressure focuses on what's too often dismissed as the soft stuff, the caring, the commitment, the compassion. And when you're a leader like Michael is, you bring people together for common cause and you do it and mobilize them for the benefit of all. So, Michael, it is such a pleasure to have you. Welcome.
Thank you, John. It's a real honor to be with you.
Great. Well, I've known of your work for years and years, so shame on me that it took me so long to get you on the show. But consider that as you're a busy guy. So let me tell them a little about you. You have a background in technology, and you actually worked on Wall Street. And there you observed the cultural differences. And so you left Wall Street in 2002 and you have written a couple of books, Fired Up or Burned Out, and The Connection Culture. And you co-founded the Culture Connection book. The Culture Connection Group. You and your colleagues have developed frameworks for training and tools, and you have worked for lots of people, and two of which pop out at me: Alan Mulally, who was then at Ford Motor Company, and our friend Francis Hesselbein, who is just an extraordinary example of all things good in our world. And talk about a person of grace, it's certainly Francis, as well as Alan. So, and you've had top clients like Costco, Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco, Sloan Memorial, NASA even, and we're going to get into that. So, and you've written a lot, and that's how I know you. So welcome, Michael. It's a pleasure to have you on the show today.
Thank you, John. It's great to be with you. I know we share our values and interests are very aligned, so it'll be a great conversation. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, great. And okay, I'm going to ask you this sort of a basic question, and it says more about my ignorance than your great knowledge. But okay, we talk about human connection. So how does it affect our emotional and physical health and subsequently performance?
Well, I like what Matthew Lieberman, who's a social cognitive neuroscientist at UCLA, I love the term he came up with, which is superpower. That connection is a superpower because it makes us smarter, happier, and more productive. But it also makes us more resilient to cope with stress. And that's really important today. Stress levels are very high. And you think of, you know, occupations like, you mentioned NASA, that's stressful for astronauts, of course. But a lot of jobs are stressful these days. And so connection really helps us. It's, in disconnection, on the other hand, to just understand the concept more holistically, is it's a super stressor that engages when we're disconnected. It triggers the stress response so that we're more vulnerable to addiction and even suicide.
Yes. And we've been in this period of social isolation, so the stress levels go up. Is there a way to quantify or qualify what a connection is? Is it transitory? Is it deep, like with a friend or a spouse? Or how do you define it, Michael? Or how is it?
Well, it's a bond based on shared identity, empathy, and understanding that moves people from self-interest to caring about the group. That's kind of a definition.
Yeah.
And it's, I think all those connections are good, John. The casual connections we have in the community, people we network with, those actually have a profound effect on our biology too. But it's those more, those closer connections, our best friends, people whose backs we have, who have our backs, those really protect us from addiction, from some of the things that I mentioned earlier, and help us thrive in life. It's really critical. And yet people are losing those these days.
No, and I'm glad you mentioned that, because one of the mainstays of my life as a senior citizen is golf. And I play golf by myself too, but I also have some good buddies that I play golf with. And we meet regularly. For a while we met virtually, and we call it our book club. Our one rule is we don't read books. about, actually, we don't discuss books. We're all book readers. We just don't discuss it. With, so that's our conceit, whatever. Yeah. But that relationship that I've had with these friends for years, really, I found it so important, especially in our period of isolation. Is that part of the human connection, Michael?
Well, it absolutely is. And so many people do connect through golf. You know, there's a lot of talking time when you're on a golf course, especially for 18 holes. And these days, you know, you're waiting for the course, so you get a lot of extra time. So I'm in a men's Bible study. I've been in about 15 years. Our oldest guy's in his 80s. Our youngest is in his 20s. It's a very diverse group. And, you know, it's a lifeline for me. I need that group to help me just cope with the stress in life.
That's great. Now, do you ever, not to get too personal, but with my, we don't always get together as a group, and sometimes we play as a twosome or just get together as friends for lunch or something. So do you have the same kind of thing with a Bible group, different friends that you connect with on a, quote, offline or off group basis?
Yeah, I do. Even last night, well, we have two guys who moved away who, you know, right now, because we're all in Zoom, two guys, one moved to Minneapolis or St. Paul, the other moved to Seattle, and has now moved back to the East Coast down in Virginia. And I was on the phone an hour last night with, or on Zoom, with a friend who moved back. So yeah, we definitely connect. We've been to each other's houses, and so we connect on and offline.
And what I thought you was interesting about you, because you talked, when you defined connection, you talked about a shared interest. And of course, with your group, it's your faith or the Bible, and it's rooted in there, and that's a wonderful connector for so many of us. So now I'm going to flip the switch, because you have actually worked for a group, and I have done a little bit of work, but not like you, for NASA. And this is so top of mind right now, because I am finishing up the series For All Mankind on Apple TV. And Apple, if you're listening, I'm promoting the series, but it's a wonderful show. It's a counterfactual thing about the space race and the quote, the Soviets get to the moon first. So, but it's human drama stuff. But there's one episode, the first station on the moon, which the whole episode, beautifully shot, they're all in isolation for an extended period of time. So how does NASA prepare its astronauts for isolation?
Well, just to add a little context, we did work years ago for 3 years with the engineering section at the Johnson Space Center, which is the largest section there. It literally is engineers and rocket scientists. And
is rocket science.
No surprise. Yeah. And we found that at that point, their interest in our work was really focused on how do we perform our best. We know we need to improve our managers and our work cultures. And part of that came out of just the space shuttle disasters. And so that opened the door for us to do work there. And as I've learned more about NASA, I find it really fascinating because, you know, two astronauts have been in space for a year roughly. And they're anticipating multi-year missions to Mars. So isolation is a real risk, and they understand that. In fact, they have PhDs on staff who study that. And I love that they use the memory device Kinect to help, you know, they prepare and train their astronauts to understand the risks of loneliness versus the benefits of connection. And the Kinect stands for, let me just tick through these real quick.
Yeah, please. Down.
See, I thought under pressure here, I might forget them. So,
don't worry, Michael. You're on live. It's okay. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Don't worry about your career.
So the Kinect stands for community, openness, networking, needs, expeditionary mindset, countermeasures, and training and preparation. So, you know, unlike all of us going into this pandemic, we, very few of us were really prepared like the NASA astronauts are, but they prepare them to understand how do you protect yourself from loneliness? What does loneliness look like? How will it manifest? And how do you protect your teammates? It's about self-care and team care. And when you think about the astronaut situation, they're in a small group that are together there on the space station, and the rest of their communications are mediated digitally. So it's in a lot of ways, and also their outside environment is threatening because there's no oxygen. And
a problem?
And our outside environment was threatening because of COVID. So there are some similarities there. And what they learned when astronauts came back from those year mission, there was it did affect their cognitive abilities. They weren't as accurate. They weren't as fast. And, you know, in solving problems. And so, you know, research would tell us that our time in somewhat in isolation compared to what we were used to before is going to affect us, including our abilities to connect, our social talents, our social skills are going to be somewhat diminished because of the time we spent away from people.
That's extraordinary. I would have thought that just the opposite, their social skills would have, quote, deteriorated, not their cognitive skills. So that's an eye opener, particularly because, as we're going to discuss, the hybrid workplace, going back to work. And I'm so glad that there's a body of literature and lots of commentators. And I know you too have written about, you know, it's not throwing a switch and we're not going back to the way we were. So tell me about your perspective, what you think of the new workplace, or excuse me, the hybrid workplace.
Well, research shows that 71% of people prefer remote work or a hybrid. Yet, I think most employers are going to want people to come back to the workplace just because of the benefits of collaboration and cooperation. So there's this disconnect between the two.
Right. A colleague of ours, Luke Harter of Best Practice Institute, did some work on that. And you know, 80% of senior executives or CEOs want their people in place, and only 20% say, "Yeah, boss." You know, and so that's a disconnect right there. So
yeah, I think a lot of people, you know, I can understand both sides.
Yeah.
But I think we're going to see three reactions from employees. First of all, there are the people, the extroverts, they're going to be so grateful to be back in the workplace. Yeah. You know, Katie, my wife and I, we've already started meeting with friends socially because we're starved for connection. We really want to get out and reconnect. And then there's going to be the group, John, who, because of that time and the way their nervous system is wired, coming back into the workplace is going to feel threatening and they're going to experience some anxiety. So this is a good time for employers to really show grace, to use your term, grace to their employees to understand these things. People are going to react differently. And then there's also going to be a group who had the personal flexibility they had in removing the commute and being able to work from home to attend to, say, children or elderly family members they're taking care of. That really took some pressure off them. And they're going to have an adjustment, too, to get back into that. So grace is really needed during this time when we reconnect as, you know, as a country and worldwide, I would say.
Yeah, thank you. I hadn't even made the connection to grace and understanding. But you're right. When I talk to my clients, I say that, you know, make your plans, and they're well underway, of course. But be prepared to throw those plans out or revise those plans once you're back in. Because, you know, the human dynamic, we all change things. Mm-hmm. So, and what I'm concerned about, just a little side concern, is the, you know, that what effect will it have on gender equity or social disparity or racial social justice issues? Because the thing about if I work from home, and my guess, I could be wrong, is more women will select to opt from work from home. So what will that do to their ability to be seen and heard and promoted? Do you have you thought about that one, Michael? So.
Well, I, you know, this is a huge natural experiment, isn't it? Just in terms of what happened with the pandemic. And I do think, you know, the rise of Me Too and Black Lives Matter, just the increased consciousness of racism and discrimination, which both of which are stressors. And we're seeing that in the data that people of color, especially, are, you know, their stress levels are very high. Right. So I think these issues will, you know, they're going to continue to be on a high level from a visibility standpoint. So I'm optimistic that I think we'll make more progress in the future. It's been painful during the pandemic, some of the things that have happened. But I think corporate America is aware of this, and I'm optimistic that it's a priority. I'm hearing it from our clients that it's a priority. And one of the things we did in the second edition of our book is we added a lot of examples of women and people of color, because I remember I was teaching a course at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and a very sincere young man of color reached out to me afterward and said, I was having a hard time connecting with your material because I didn't see people who looked like me. And, you know, I wasn't even aware of that, John. Right. I was just grateful.
It's like me. Yes.
Yeah. And so we had a really nice exchange, and he helped me. He actually even looked at some of our materials, and it was very helpful. It helped me see a blind spot I had and something I could adapt to. So we really changed the second edition of our book to be very intentional about inclusion.
Right. And inclusion, that is the operative word, because we talk about diversity, of course, but inclusion means, to my way, at least from a management perspective, means a seat at the table, decision making. And that is what's so important. And we need to have that. And once we do, then things change. So that's the positive aspect. So you have connection culture is your what you focus on and help organizations build thriving culture. So you talk about human needs to thrive. What are some of those needs that we want to fulfill when we're at work? So,
well, one of the first things we did when I left, you know, I worked on Wall Street. I saw that 4 out of 5 mergers failed to create economic value. And I saw often that there was a disconnect after the acquisition or the merger where the two cultures clashed.
Yes.
And it prevented them from executing the plan going into the transaction. And so I became interested in culture. I ended up leaving Wall Street and studying it. One of the first things we did was really look at the research that was out there already. And we came up with 6 needs to thrive. And we actually added one in recent years. And I think of it this way, John, when we first join a group, they don't know us. And so at a minimum, though, we expect that they'll be respectful because we're humans and we should respect each other. And then if we're there longer, and we've had a chance to show what we can do, we have an expectation that people will let us know that they think we're doing good work. If they don't, that affects our performance too, if we just radio silence. And then as we're there longer, John, then we develop relationships and friendships, people whose backs we have, who have our backs. And that's a sense of belonging that just helps us get through difficult times.
Right.
And also when people are candid and speak truth and love, that helps us grow and see things, blind spots we have, et cetera. Right. And then there's autonomy. We need the freedom to do our work. We need to be in a role that's a good fit with our strengths. Can't be over-challenging so they're stressed out, or under-challenging so that we're bored. And so that produces what we call personal growth, is that need. And then the need for meaning, that we're making a difference through our work in some way, and that we're making progress. That was the last need that we added. And when those needs are met, people describe it as feeling connected. They feel connected to their work, to their colleagues, to the people they serve, to their boss, and to the organization. It just helps them thrive.
Great. No, it's so well founded there. And I liked how you opened with respect. That is the, in my model, grace, that's R. And it's, in a way, it's defining people, viewing them with an open heart. And when you join a group, as you know far better than I do, it's you want to feel belonging, of course, but so often it doesn't occur. And I don't know that it's of malice, but it's people like, well, you know, I don't know this person very well, so I'm going to hang back. Do you have some advice on that if you're bringing new people onto your team, action steps to do?
Yeah, in our research, we found there are 3 types of relational cultures. Cultures that connect people, that's what we want, obviously. Cultures that are indifferent to people, John, because they're so focused on tasks. You know, that's Wall Street, is mostly people are focused on tasks, you know, that help.
Well, I've often thought of Wall Street as a very warm and friendly, kind place. I guess not. Shame
there
on
are
me.
Warm and friendly people on Wall Street, but not for the most part. And then the last is a culture of control. So, but, you know, like you said, we have to be intentional. And I think getting leaders to understand, but not only leaders, everyone in a culture has a role to play to make sure that everybody feels connected, because we have to feel connected to give our best performance. And so those differences that get in the way of connection, you know, they hold back the group's performance. And so we really have to be intentional for people who look like they're pulling away or becoming disconnected, and, you know, reach out our hand to pull them back in so that they feel like a part of the group. And, you know, just number one, being sensitive to that is job one. And then taking the initiative to, you know, find common ground with them, to maybe take them out for a coffee or a drink after work, just anything to make them feel a part of the team is especially important.
Right. I'm glad you mentioned that. One of our colleagues, you may know her, Ruth Gotian, talks about high achieve. She, her research is on, she works at, I think, Cornell Weill Medical Center. And so she talks about high achievement. And as you were talking about Wall Street, and I was just teasing about it, it is highly competitive. And you think of other things like classically the Navy SEALs or whatever there's, but you know, about them, that's a different dynamic. Do you think there's a lot of fear in these high, I mean, there's an esprit de corps of sense of high achievement and we're all super people. Mm-hmm. But isn't there an underlying thing of fear? I'm going to lose my place too, where it becomes kind of ugly. So.
Yeah. I think those disconnectors, John, I think they're driven by fear. You know, their achievement is driven by fear. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they view their teammates often as competitors.
Right.
And, you know, you just don't get great teams when you view your teammates as competitors. Yeah. One of the things I liked about John Wooden, I think you know a lot about John Wooden, too.
Oh, yeah.
I shared this with my kids that it's, you know, having that mindset that a winner is someone who gives their best effort and perseveres because we don't actually control the outcome. And things, you know, there are extraneous factors that affect outcome that we have no control of, right. But we do have control of our effort and perseverance. And over time, we are going to win a lot when we give our best effort and persevere. I think that's just a brilliant perspective that he brought to his team and to all of us who are admirers of his work.
Right. No, it's a great story about him that when he was the job he had before UCLA, he really wanted to stay. Well, he's a Purdue guy, so he wanted to stay mm-hmm. be in the Big Ten. And he had two offers, one from Minnesota and one from UCLA. And that was 1948, something like that. Wonderful. And he really wanted to go to the University of Minnesota to be the coach. And UCLA called and he said yes. And then like an hour later, Minnesota called and they said, we'd like you. And he said, no, I already gave my word to UCLA. And how the basketball world is completely different because he did that. But, you know, talk about a man of honor. He really wanted to go there. And he said, well, I gave them my word, so I'm going west. You know, you don't see that in coaching these days.
So. Yeah, that's a great story, John. I also really appreciate John Wooden for at a time when there was, you know, there was a lot of discrimination against people of color. He, when he was a coach at Indiana State, he a young man of color, Clarence Walker, who played for him, who was the only young man of color on his team. And at that time, the NCAA, which is the NAIB back then, just to be accurate, they did not allow young men of color to play in the postseason tournament. And John Wooden turned down the offer to play in the postseason tournament because he would not let Clarence be humiliated.
Yep.
The next year, the NAIB changed the rules and they allowed him to come. And the second year, they offered Coach Wooden that Clarence could come and play, but he couldn't stay with the team.
That's right.
Appearance. So he stayed with the minister's family. His Clarence's family wanted him to go.
Yeah.
And so Coach agreed to it and he got to play in the game and Indiana State lost in the they lost to Louisville in the finals.
Yeah.
So in the next year, they opened up postseason basketball to all young men of color. Yeah. So it was John Wooden who had the courage to do that.
Well, that's a good story. I did not know that about him. And there's something else about you, the culture of connection. You have a concept called mosaic thinking. Tell us about that, Michael.
Well, when you study innovation, a lot of innovation comes from people connecting ideas that are in disparate fields of knowledge. So, for example, Picasso took European portraiture painting and African masks and combined it and created a whole new style of, you know, the Cubist style of art. Or one of my favorites is someone came up with a brilliant idea of combining waffles with chicken and came up with chicken waffles, which I love.
Yeah. I don't know if that's a good thing, Mike, but it tastes good.
It sounds awful. When I first heard about it, I was like, what? That sounds terrible.
Yeah.
But it's actually very good. And so when you understand that these disparate pieces of knowledge are combined together and you back up and think, what what creates that? It's people who have broad knowledge, and you know, they're plugged into a marketplace of ideas that's feeding what's in their heads, and then connecting people through a culture where they're brainstorming and sharing their ideas, and then those ideas collide and create something new.
Right.
So that's mosaic thinking is, you know, you know, combining these pieces. If you think of a mosaic, it's all these tiles that are put together and form a beautiful image. That beautiful image isn't formed unless you have a culture and people whose ideas come together.
All the more reason for diversity and inclusion. Hiring Absolutely. People different from ourselves. People mm-hmm. think different. Neurodiversity. All mm-hmm. embracing all of us, because we all have something to give if we are in the right place. And so that, I like this idea of mosaic thinking. If I'm not mistaken, that's kind of an underlying philosophy for the design firm IDEO, because they have different disciplines for every, when they do a design project, they have people from different disciplines working together. So they're not all quote creative. They, you know, there's a discipline to the system, which is great. So, and then do you have a model you want to share with us about a connection culture? Is there something that's,
yeah, you can sure. describe? Sure. You know, over years, we've found that managers we've trained, they have really loved our model for connection culture, which is task excellence plus relationship excellence equals sustainable superior performance. And relationship excellence has three components, vision, value, and voice. Or when a leader communicates an inspiring vision that unites people, when they value people as individuals and don't treat them merely as means to an end, and when they give them a voice to share their ideas and consider them, that creates connection. And so that model really creates a connection culture.
That's powerful, and it's aligned with my thinking. I have done a lot of work in purpose, and I say purpose is creates your vision and mission. Mm-hmm. And we all know that you can achieve those vision and mission in spite of people. Mm-hmm. But how much better is it to do it with people, as you say, vision and voice, and that's where grace comes in. Grace becomes our how we connect to others. So, Michael, I always ask all of our guests as we come close to the end, a story of grace. And I know you have one, and do you want to share it with us, please?
Sure, John. I have a lot of them. I've been really blessed by much grace over the course of my life. But one that really stood out to me was when my wife, Katie, was diagnosed. She's a 3-time cancer survivor.
Oh, my goodness.
And when she was diagnosed with breast and advanced ovarian cancer, her chances of survival were less than 10%. And we actually, two of our clients treated her. One is Yale New Haven Health, and then Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. And I remember our first visit to Sloan Kettering. We're walking down the street in Midtown Manhattan, and this doorman named Nick Medley locks his eyes on Katie and smiles and he greets her like she's a returning best friend. It really surprised me in a town where no one makes eye contact.
Yeah.
to see her reaching out. And, you know, we met Nick, then we went in the lobby and the receptionist was calling everyone honey, also very unusual in Manhattan. The security and the administrative people were helpful and friendly. Our oncologist, Dr. Marty Hensley, was upbeat and optimistic and educated us. And even though, John, when I went down the street and there was probably a cloud over my head because I was expecting a culture of death and dying,
yeah.
But I found it was a culture of life and living. And today earlier this year, we celebrated Katie's 16th year of being cancer-free from ovarian cancer and 5th year of being free from triple negative breast cancer. Wow. And Sloan Kettering and Yale New Haven are both clients now. So we are so grateful to them for the compassion and grace they showed us. And it's a joy for us to serve them through our work.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful story. And pre-COVID, I had the pleasure and privilege of playing piano in hospital lobbies. That's how good I am. Yeah. They promised me that the talent agents would see me. But seriously, and I my ideas of grace were strengthened by the daily connections I saw between staff and patients and patients' families. And your story is just right in there. And I'm so glad you talked about it, because it's a big issue, your wife's health, of course, but how they treated her as a person, not as a patient. They made that personal connection. And that's what grace is. It's the it can be those little micro connections, to use mm-hmm. your term, but also in that holistic sense of this is the way we act. And what a positive difference that makes. And I would argue that it promotes healing. Would you mm-hmm. not?
Yes. Research shows that patients who have that social support of connection, they have better outcomes on average than those who don't. And I believe that's because of the stress response. When people sure. feel connected, their bodies are at a state of homeostasis or balance. So blood glucose and oxygen goes to all the systems that need it. And when they're in a stress response, some systems are shortchanged. So I think that just helps disease in terms of making us more susceptible to disease.
Great. Well, you have been a terrific guest, and unfortunately, time has gone way, way too fast. Michael, how can people find you?
Well, they could go to my website, michaelleestaller.com, and our business is connectionculture.com.
Okay, great. Well, we will put those in the notes. And with that, I will say goodbye and thank you, my friend, for being with us today.
Thank you, John. I appreciate it.